Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the fourth day of refresher course for DISA AT examination course. I welcome today's speaker, our chairman, J. Srinivasa Garu, C.H. Engalindi sir, our RCM, and Aditya Mukka, Karimnagar branch. I hand over opening remarks for Aditya. So hand over to Aditya sir.
Thank you, Raghu Garu. Good morning, dear participants. I have been invited by Guntur branch to give my opening remarks as chairman of Karimnagar branch. Karimnagar branch is located in the city of Karimnagar, which is 150 kilometers from Hyderabad. Relatively young branch, inaugurated in 2014 and promoted to small category with a member strength of around 300. It is a well-known fact that DISA is the basic criteria for bank systems audit as well as concurrent audits for few banks. But year on year, more number of banks are insisting for DISA as one of the basic criteria for bank concurrent audit. Even I came across discussions where our members were discussing and telling about that DISA will become one of the basic criteria in future for statutory bank audit also. I'm not sure whether those words can be trusted or relied upon, but for sure this might happen in near future where banks will insist for even for statutory audit also. These issues highlight the importance of acquiring DISA qualification. There are many members who stopped the course midway just by clearing PT or ET. I appeal to all those members from this platform to complete the assessment test at the earliest. And I appreciate Guntur branch for hosting such a beautifully conceptualized and presenting this refresher course with expert faculty. Kudos to GKR sir, an expert in multiple subjects, be it valuation, bankruptcy code, systems audit, costing, taxation, whatever. Words are not sufficient to acknowledge its contribution to the members of ICAI. Not only members, even non-members are getting benefited from his virtual lectures. The best example is my younger brother, Vishnu. He's an MBA graduate who attended GKR sir valuation classes last year and he completed his valuation course. And my best wishes to the participants attending the upcoming assessment test conducted by our institute in the month of July. And I thank Chairman J. Srinivasa Garu and the Managing Committee of Guntur branch for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, Sikasa Raghunandan Garu. Please take over the session.
Thank you, Aditya Garu. Now I request our speaker for the session, Gopalakrishnan Garu sir, to hand over the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Just 1 minute. Share the screen. Very good morning to one and all, especially to all the organizers, chairman of the respective branches, ex officio member of the 13 branches, and my very good friend, Mr. Chengal Reddy.
I am not ex officio for all 13 branches, sir.
Okay, for the branches for which we are ex officio. Today's topic will be a very, very interesting topic. But before I begin this, I wish to share a little bit of information before I start. When the day one was inaugurated, we were totally we don't know whether there will be an assessment test will be conducted on. So it is fortunate that we had the examination committee member as part of our inauguration, and he took that step to make it a point to announce it timely. And today we are before us, the examination is there. So this is a very crucial time for every one of us to utilize the available time, maximize our understanding and learning, and clear the assessment test. There are interesting questions that emanate because of the syllabus 2.0 and 3.0. Actually, when 2.0 is there, we also have 1.0 syllabus. That is the original syllabus. Then it was revised. Now you have a 3.0 syllabus. So they have made it very clear that old syllabus and new syllabus, they will conduct examination. I want to make only one observation here, that in the previous syllabus and the current syllabus, not much of, not much of a difference with respect to syllabus, except for one topic, that is called emerging technologies. In the previous syllabus, that is called old syllabus, in old syllabus, we had 7 chapters. And in 7 chapters, the 7th chapter is business continuity management, BCM. And now today, where is BCM? BCM is now included in 2nd chapter. If you look at the 7 chapters, the 1st chapter is primer on information technology and emerging technologies. Very, very basic definitions about cloud computing will be there. But today, you have a separate module, and under that module, you have a separate chapter for cloud computing. So, my point to all of you, please be very clear that fundamentally, there is not much of a difference except for enrichment and maybe in accounting standard language, there are some reclassification. There are some reclassification of the chapters, like your chapter number 3 and chapter number 7 of old syllabus has now become chapter 2. And your system development, acquisition, maintenance, and implementation, which is 5th chapter in your old syllabus, is now your 3rd chapter. So, like that, some reorganization has happened. In the reclassification, they have also enriched the current syllabus. Today, you are going to see that. Today, you are going to see, for example, your chapter number 4 in old syllabus will be chapter number 5 in 3.0. Tomorrow, Dr. Paul Jayagar will take you to chapter number 5 in 3.0, which is chapter number 4 in your old syllabus. So, I will only say it is a reconciliation. So, maybe if you wish to have a reconciliation between your old syllabus and new syllabus, I've asked my team to prepare a small template. I will just vet it, and during my 6th day, I will show you that comparison so that you will have a connect between your old syllabus and new syllabus. So, point to be noted, whether you are in old syllabus or new syllabus, my view is, please prepare up to date. Please prepare up to date. It will help you to handle any kind of situation. And I want to make one more observation. I am sure the other faculties also would have made it, that whenever the options are given to you, that is the correct answer and the wrong answers. So your wrong options will not necessary. It should be only from your the respective chapter. It can also be crisscrossed from your entire syllabus. So that is why you need to have a grip on the entire syllabus. So from this moment onwards, we are not divided as old syllabus and new syllabus. We are only united with respect to getting a qualification called information post-qualification course on information systems audit. So that is our objective. Now, with this very brief prelude, let me now take you into the subject. Good. Now, I will share the screen. Yeah. This topic has 4 units. So, 4.1, 2, 3, and 4. About information systems management, information systems operations, and the software operations and management, incident response and management. Each of this you need to actually appreciate from a technical perspective. So I will be very practical, technical come practical. Okay, so that we appreciate the terminologies. Most important in your information system audit syllabus is you need to understand the terms. You need to understand what it conveys. So then you can crack the question very easily. Good. So let me now take you into the subject now. Yeah, information systems management. Which of the following is a common policy? I repeat that, is a common feature in all the policies. Now, as the question suggests, that means you have policies in an organization. So what can be a policy? The policy is, for example, security policy, backup policy, and your disaster recovery planning is also a policy only. Now, how you will actually recover? Your business continuity planning is also a policy only. Accounting policy is also a policy. HR policy is also a policy. Okay, encryption policy. Now, please look at this term. Which of the following is a common feature for all the policies? Okay, now, encryption policy standards. When you have to apply certain standards, example, you have standards like COBIT. COBIT is actually one assurance standard. You can adopt that. You can adopt that for your organization. There is no mandate that you have to follow it. So it is a voluntary adoption of a standard. So acceptable use and process. Now, if you look at all this, process seems to be, which is the common feature for all the policy. Process is a very generic term. It's a very generic term. So it doesn't fit to the question at all. But encryption, standards, acceptable use seems to be somewhat connected with policy. Now you need to understand the term called common feature. Okay, common feature. Now I will take encryption policy. Now encryption, which you will encrypt, you will only encrypt a confidential data. A confidential data only you will encrypt. Good. Now, when you have to encrypt the confidential data, who will actually have to approve the encryption? The user only has to say. Sometimes you need to understand something called as Mr. Vittal Raj or Dr. Paul, I don't know. Please understand something that certain things I'll keep it private. Certain things I'll keep it private. If it is private, I may not even encrypt it. I will not allow access at all to anybody. So please understand the difference between encryption and privacy. So when it is privacy, maybe I wish to have encrypted. Maybe in case somebody access, they may not be decrypting. I will not give access at all. Then is the question of decrypting an encrypted data. So when the access itself is not given, it becomes private. So this encryption is not a common feature. It depends upon the respective user. So encryption is not answer. Process is not answer. Standards and acceptable use. Remember one thing. Application of standards depends upon the management's I will call it as attribute. No. We will develop why we should have a rigid standard. It is very. It doesn't fit to our. Our management policy doesn't fit to our organization's methods and practices. So sometimes standards will prescribe the certain procedures, certain process. You may not be following it. So that is why common feature is organizations adopting standard as a policy to follow a standard is not routine. We have various standards, ITIL. Information technology, that library, it is actually one standard. COBIT is one standard. So various international standards are there. So you wish to adopt it, you adopt. Sometimes you will take the best practices alone. Entire standard also will not take. That is why common feature standard also will not. Now, what is acceptable use? Anything, for example, user has to always give sign off. Today, we have a very big, government has actually been mocked for one thing, which is, should not be done. It is unfortunate that the income tax website, the new website actually should not be done by people. They should not mock at all. It is not a joke actually to a legacy system to a new system. It is a very serious thing. Definitely there will be issues. It is not that you can only find fault with Infosys. You can also say that whenever a developer, yesterday you would have gone through SDLC. In SDLC, there is a lot of steps is there. In the last step, it is called user acceptance, UAT, user acceptance testing. That user will actually has to use it. That means who's user? Ministry of Finance. Maybe they can take 10 SSEs and they will be testing it, everything. Then the user acceptance testing will be signed. There is one agreement. Then only it will go live. It cannot go live without a user acceptance testing. So something, it is not that we can only blame the developer alone. Equally, we should also, the person who has given the job is also equally, who's user here? They will also equally responsible. This user acceptance is a common feature. Whether it is system development, whether it is encryption, who has to say? The owner, data owner has to say. So 1C. So please understand, it is 1C. Good. Now come to the next one. Acceptable usage policy. This is acceptable usage policy. It means it is a set of rules applied by the owner, creator. Okay. Good. Which of the following is not a HR function? This is actually not a technical question at all. It is a non-technical question. So this kind of question, you can just like that. So out of your 150 marks, the minimum which you have to take. So out of 200, 150 is your cutoff. So I can assure you that at least 10 to 20 marks will be these kind of general questions. Okay. So you need to actually focus on these kind of general questions also. Okay. Now, my dear friends, do not populate the chat box with answers. Unless and otherwise, I tell you to type the answers. You write your answers in your use. You have a pen, pencil, notebook is there. There you have to write, not in chat, unless and otherwise. I mentioned that you have to type it here. Okay. Don't type the answers until I prompt you. Good. Which of the following is not a HRM function? Now here, recruitment is a HR function. Appraisal, HR function. Security policy approval. Security training. This word training is actually HR. Okay. So recruitment is a HR function. Training is HR function. Appraisal of people, their elevation, HR function. But approval, it is top management. Okay. That is a policy. That security, we were just now discussing about many policies. This approval is not HR function. It is top management. Okay. So 2C. Good. While which of the following training, okay, which of the following training an employee can, unless and otherwise, I request the members to type it in chat. Don't type it anything and don't divert the attention of the members. Kind. A request to all of you. Okay. Unless and otherwise, it is prompted. Which of the following training an employee can acquire while working on his or his desk in the office? Okay. Which of the following training an employee can acquire? Now, this is very interesting. And all of us, we have experienced. What is it? E-learning, simulator-based training, instructor led training, hands are training. Now connect this with the question then. Okay, all are training, all answers are training, but can I go while working on his or her desk? Please look at this. So I am on my desk. So which will be a training while I'm sitting on a desk in the office? Simulator based training means simulation means situation. I want to drive a car. I want to drive a car, but I don't drive an actual car because I may dash it. Okay. So I will be given a simulation as though I'm sitting in a car seat. I'll be given a steering and there will be a very big screen. That is called simulation. So there I will try to drive and I'll try to get the feel and I will get experienced. So simulator based training for a four wheeler, two wheeler, aircraft. These are all simulation based training. Is it in his desk? No. Instructor led training. So that means there will be a lab. Instructor will help me. Okay, do like this, don't do like this. Okay, that is also not in my desk. Hands-on training. Hands-on training will be done generally in a lab environment. Okay, where maybe instructor will be there or I will be given a case study environment. I have to do that. I have to experience it. Okay, so that I get a grip on the subject. So that is called hands-on. So why it is called hands-on? I have to experience it. So I'll do 5 or 10 exercises. I'll try that Excel. Now, Microsoft Excel is a spreadsheet. So I'll be given some 10-20 cases or workings. I have to try that in a lab environment. And maybe if I'm getting stuck, I will ask instructor, please come and help me. Instructor-led training means the instructor will be there. He will be teaching parallelly and I will be also doing it parallelly. So that is it. E-learning. So Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, e-learning hub. That is while working on his desk, 3A. Okay, good. For an unexpected and sudden changes. Okay, for an unexpected and sudden changes. Okay, all these questions are there in your study material, in your mock test paper, in your 1,000 question papers. Okay, point is, I don't want answers from you. I want you to understand why the other three answers are wrong. Don't focus on answers. If you want to focus on answers, answers are there in study material, your 1,000 mock test paper, it is there. The purpose of this session is not to focus on answers. Focus on the question, clarity on the concepts, why the other three is wrong. That is the purpose of this session. Okay. So until I prompt you, don't type anything on the chat box for an unexpected and sudden changes. Look at this word. In technology, organizations need to be. Now, please understand the situation. What can be an unexpected and sudden changes? Okay. Example, virus attack. The virus attack will be sudden. Okay. So that means your system will be hampered. Okay, it will not work. Some application may not function. Okay, your connectivity is severed. So all these it need not be only virus attack. For example, power outage. There can be a fluctuate surge in power because of that your connection, your connectivity, power connection is burst. Okay, that transformer or transponder is burst. That is also a sudden change. Okay, unexpected. Now in technology, then because of the power is not there, nothing can be done. Connectivity gone. Okay, so then what to do? Organization need to be innovative. What is it to be innovation? Innovation is from one orbit, you have to go to the next bigger orbit. You are in a small orbit. The radius is 5 centimeters. You want to go to the next 8 centimeter radius. That means bigger orbit. Okay, so that means more people, more capacity. Okay, so more bandwidth, more power for your hardware and facilities in software, connectivities. So that is innovation. That has nothing to do with. So A is not answer. So answer is between B, C, and D. Expert, why do you need an expert? We may need an expert, but until and otherwise, you know what that change is. Which expert you have to go? Will you go to a hardware expert, or to go to a software expert, or to a telecom expert, or to an electrical expert? We don't know the sudden change, no. So therefore, expert is not the immediate answer. Doer is a very general term. I cannot ignore the word doer, but I'll go to agile. Agile means agility. Agility means you should be stable, but you must act quickly and swiftly because of an unexpected and sudden change. Oh my God, what to do next? Okay, generally it happens with I used to tell the failed students and all, I used to say, you need to be agile. So something has happened. Okay, what next you have to do? Okay, that is most important. Unexpected and sudden changes. Okay, so organization need to be agile. Okay, agile. Okay, good. Who owns the data? Simple, actually. This is the starting point. Please understand. On this, there will be a lot of questions. Okay, the data owner. Okay, who owns the data? Okay, data owner. So system owner, process owner, data custodian. Please understand the difference between data custodian and data owner. Finance department, finance manager, he will be the data owner for the finance related, for example, entry. Okay, for accounts manager, we'll take why finance manager, manager accounts. Okay, GM accounts. GM accounts is the data owner for all the entries that are passed into the system, because ultimately GM only will be the ultimate authority for accounts. Of course, there will be many divisions, vertical people will be keying in the data, but the ultimate owner will be the GM accounts. Okay, I'm just giving one designation. So data owner, who owns the data in a department? Finance department, accounts department. Similarly, it can be a stores department. The stores data. Okay, sometimes we call it as the PSL. PSL is different. The companies, they use a different name. Stores ledger account. This is what in costing we would have heard it. We would have learned it. But in some company, they'll use a word called PSL. It's called priced stores ledger. Stores ledger account, they use a word called PSL, priced stores ledger. So PSL. So some of the companies, for example, companies like Ashok Leyland, if they take the PSL printout in 1 month, nowadays printouts are not taken. Okay, if at all the printouts are taken, there will be, the part numbers will be almost 27,000 parts. So that means that they have to maintain prices for 27,000 parts, because all this only will constitute into one chassis, one vehicle. So then imagine. So who's the data owner as far as that price store ledger is concerned? The stores man or factory manager. Okay. Is it a department? So data owner, 5D. Greatest challenge. This is the most, I will say, difficult kind of question. Greatest, primary, most, least. Why? All our answers. You can't ignore. That is the problem with our examination. Okay. You understand this. The real challenge is these kind of questions. See, questions like this is very easy, because we know one is the answer, other three are wrong. Here also one is the answer, other three are wrong straight away. But here it is not that. All four are answers. The greatest challenge in outsourcing data processing, that means other three are also challenge. Now you have to prioritize it. Very, very, very important. You have to prioritize it. Okay. So like in your family members, father, mother, spouse, children, daughter, brother-in-law, sister-in-law, son-in-law, daughter-in-law. So who you want to give what you call priority? Okay, that means the more without them, you will actually miss them in your life. So if you give a priority, it's very difficult. It's very difficult, but that is the time you will understand who will be very close to you. The greatest challenge in outsourcing, that means, doesn't mean that the That one, that person alone is very close to you. Others are also close. But there is a small delta difference. That's all. Outsourcing. Now let me go one by one. Cost. Naturally, cost. If cost is high, I'll go for outsourcing because if I have to do it. So that is also one reason. So you cannot ignore cost also. Okay. Data integrity. So I will say data integrity. Out greatest challenge in outsourcing data processing. If I outsource my organization's data to a third party, my data is compromised. They know about my company. They know about my debtors, creditors, my inventory, my segmental reports. So they know my in and out. They know my strength. More so, they will know my weakness also. So that is very, very, I will say, so data integrity. Now the data is with them. They can tamper the data. They can change the data because I am only dependent on them. So that is a challenge. But is it greatest? So distance. I will say data integrity is a challenge. Please wait. Distance, actually, because of technology, if your outsourced person is in Australia. Okay, Australia, there is a server. And in Australia, in Melbourne, near to Melbourne, outer Melbourne, there is a server. Is it a challenge? No, it is not a challenge. So distance is not a challenge. Cost generally will not be a challenge. Why? Because you go to outsourcing because the cost will be cheaper. Cost will be competitive. That is why you go for outsourcing. So B and D is not an answer. Generally for outsourcing. So naturally A and C. But now is the biggest challenge before you. Confidentiality lost. Integrity, because he may tamper the data. Now, between A and C, greatest challenge. Both are challenge. Both are challenge, but greatest means first challenge. Remember, integrity is compromised only because of confidentiality. Confidentiality is compromised. That is why integrity. So first confidence. It is not integrity compromise after that confidentiality. No. Data is given to him. So therefore, confidentiality gone. Therefore, he actually has that greed. Oh, why not we change the data? Okay. Very, very important. Okay. So data confidentiality. 6A. Okay. 6A. Now, let me take you to the next question. And my request to all of you, don't type anything. I'll give you the choice to you. Note down the questions. Note down the questions. Don't type anything in chat box until I tell you, don't type anything. I'll give you the chance to raise your hand. I will unmute you. I'll request you to unmute. You speak. I want you to speak. I want to hear, and others also should hear. Okay, good. So let us be very clear. All of us are professionals. Let us be very serious. Which one of the following combinations of roles should be greatest concern for IS auditor? Okay. Which one of the following combinations? Now, this is very serious question. Okay. This kind of questions are, I will not say rare. These kind of questions are definite in exam. Definite. Don't miss this question, I'm telling you. Okay. This is a definite question. Maybe they may change this model, giddle, some order and all, they'll change. But this is a definite question. Okay. Which one of the following combo, again, is a greatest concern? That means all four are concerns. My God. All four are concerns. Okay. So that means you need to understand their roles. You need to understand their roles. Then only you have to go for it. Okay. Now, let me now take you to, this is actually, I will say, of all the questions, this is most important question. Most important question. Okay. Good. Now, let me come to the question. System analyst and database administrator, end user and security administrator, security administrator, system programmers. You need to, first of all, understand their work, their role. If you understand the role, answer over. The problem with this kind of question is we will not be in a position to understand the role. So that is why whenever we had an opportunity to, in an audit, go to these people, ask them, hey, what are you doing? What is your job profile? Tell me that. I want to know your job profile. So what and all you do? What you can't do? So this is first thing you need to understand as an auditor. Okay. Then day one, we were discussing about something called as vulnerability, risk assessment, the threat. So all this stuff. So there's a risk, how you will actually measure only when you know their roles. Okay. Now let me come to the first one. System analyst and database administrator. Database administrators are data custodians. Data custodians. Okay. So they will manage the database. They will also ensure the security of the database. Okay. They only will be giving the access. Okay. The mandatory access control or discretionary access control to the database. There are many functions for a database administrator. I'm just giving one or two. So database administrator is also taking care of system analyst. Now, what is called the system analyst? Now, remember the term called as a data analyst. Data analyst means the guy will actually do the averaging, graph, comparison, all this thing. System analyst is a guy who will actually be at the background. He will do the analysis of especially with respect to information systems. It can be programmed. Okay. It can be programmed. He will be the person who will, if the things are not working, we'll call a system analyst. See, it is not working. Find out what is it. So it is not something related to hardware, but it is related to software. Software is not functioning. So he will go find out whether the operating systems are fine, whether the connect between the application and operating systems are well. And he can go to the back door and log in, and he will find out whether the application is running at the back end or has it stopped. So all this analysis they will do. So system analyst roles are quite vast. Okay. So system analyst role, database administrator, both are done by same person. I won't say no to this. Okay. It is a concern. I won't say no to this, but it is a concern. But the question is greatest concern. Okay. Now come to two. C. End users are security administrator for critical application. Now, who is end user? End user is the data owner. Okay, I am the user. So sometimes end user, data owner can be a difference also. For example, I am the finance manager. Okay, so I am the works manager, I am the factory manager. So I am the data owner. But the end user can be actually the officers or the line managers. Okay, or the third level, okay, or the operational level staff, okay. So they are end users. And end users are security administrators. Oh, so for critical application, what is critical application? We can call this as a transaction processing system. What is transaction? Online OLTP. OLTP, online transaction processing means, so I am connected with 10, 20 terminals and the server is in one particular place. So transaction happens from all place. Okay. So the security means data access with that too with respect to the access to the data, entry to the database. So security administrator are the guys who will actually in the gate. Okay. Are you giving the correct password? I'll verify with the password. And then if it is wrong, I will not allow. Otherwise, I'll allow inside. Or I will allow you to reset the password. So then end users or security administrator, I won't say no here. I will say it is also a concern. So B is also a concern. C is also a concern. Oh, but highest concern, my God, security administrator. Oh, once again, security administrator is coming. Okay. Our system programmers. Who is system programmer? Those who develop the code. Who security? So security administrator. They only give the access to the database. This is a I will say concern. I will also say a very big concern. Programming also he does. The security administration also he does. It is of C and D. B is actually a concern which is greater than C and D. Okay, but greater than C and D because it is almost compromised totally. Programming is also with him. Access also with them. Mudinji poch. That's all. Network administrator will oversee the network traffic. Okay. And maybe regulate the traffic if traffic is more. So all this stuff a network administrator will do. Are responsible for quality assurance. This is not a concern at all. Because he wants to actually maintain that everybody is given. So it is called as availability. You have to aligned in this in terms of CIA. What is CIA? Confidentiality, integrity, availability. A is with respect to availability. He is only concerned with availability of, availability means access. The moment you access one website, you type that, website is opening. So that is quality assurance. Okay, the fight is faster, speed. Moment you type, you are able to access. So that is administrator, responsible quality assurance. So this is actually fine tuning. So I will not, I need not worry about confidentiality and integrity. This is only availability. Availability is not a greatest concern. Availability will enhance my, my efficiency. That's it. Okay. So it is not a concern at all. So BCD is a concern. Out of BCD, B is the greatest concern. Okay. B is the greatest concern. Please understand the roles. If you don't understand the roles, you cannot touch this question at all. Govinda. Okay. So accountability for the maintenance of appropriate security measures over the information assets resides with. This word accountability is very important. Okay. Who is accountable for maintenance of appropriate security measures or information assets? Resides with whom? Security administrator, system administrator. So that means all these are roles, function. You must understand. See, security administrator, system administrator. Please understand the main difference. Security administrator is concerned with who should be given access, who should not be given access. He is only concerned about the confidentiality. Of course, if confidentiality is compromised, integrity gone. So that is why CIA, it is coming in that order. So security system administrator. So security administrator is more focused on, I repeat the word, confidentiality. System administrator is more focused on the efficiency. Okay, no. See, my system is slow. The application system is stuck somewhere. Print is not coming. Network, I'm not able to access that particular system. See, my login is not working. If I try second time only, it is working. System date is wrong. So he will come with a lot of system related issues. It is more concerned with the efficiency. My system is slow. Okay. My system is having more data. Please transfer it to someplace. I need to free my space. So many things you can speak about system administration. So system administration, certain things administrator will allow. Then you can free up the space. Certain things it will not allow you to delete at all. Can you delete your data in your system or in your local disk? Your system will not allow that. Security administrator is different. System administrator, he will not allow that. Sometimes what will do, if you delete it, there will be a ghost copy copied in the network server. So that is called system administrator. System administrator's job is to ensure efficiency. Okay. Remember the difference between efficiency and effectiveness. Leaders must be effective. Managers must be efficient. Okay. Efficiency is improvement. Effectiveness is result oriented. Okay. Data and systems owners. Wow. Data and system owner. I'm the owner of the my data. I'm only accountable for it. Security administrator, job given. System administrator, job delegated. Data and system owner, I am accountable for my data. Okay, I'm only accountable. I only have to design my user acceptance policy, privacy, confidentiality. I only have to decide. So I am only accountable for the maintenance of the appropriate security measures. So C is the answer. But why not D? system operations group. Now this system operations group, we are going to see some more inputs. They are also with respect to improvement in your efficiency. We are going to see something called a SIEM, S-I-E-M, Security Information and Event Management and Security Operations Center. Okay, that is called SOC. We are going to see that in the next few slides. What is called SOC, Security Operations Center. So they will be actually monitoring the traffic. They only monitor, they take the log, and the log they will actually analyze who is coming in, who is going out. And if something is threat, then it has to be intimated to the respective, maybe to the security administrator, and then security administrator will block. So system operations group are monitoring group. Please understand. Okay. So accountability, I will say they have delegated some work. I will not say they are accountable. Okay, they are responsible for their work. The accountability is something in a higher pedestal. Okay, so that is why D is not the answer. The decision making environment of an operations level manager can be correct. This is actually a general question. The moment you read a question, you must immediately remember general questions and all tapu tapu tapu. You should answer tapu tapu. Okay, because this is straight question. Decision making environment of a operation level means top level, middle level, operation level are always structured. Middle level is structured and semi-structured, and top level is always semi-structured, because every day new things will come. They should be dynamic. They cannot be like a horse. Okay, you come, you this means this, this means don't do this, it didn't mean don't do this. That is called structured. Operation level, they should always be structured. Now, about 10,000 cash entry, can I pass? No. The factory manager will have an authority for making expenditure up to 50,000 rupees only. Yes. It's all structured. Okay. So, many things like this will be there. So, decision making. This is totally not IT related question at all. It is management question. So, 9A. Okay. So, unstructured will not. It is structured. Okay. Which department is most likely to store PII data? This is PII means your name, driver's license, medical records, your photograph, IP address of your mobile and your connectivity of your desktop, your passport number, your bank account number. So all these will be stored. Okay. Most likely, that means other department also will store this data. But most likely, who will store your personally identifiable data? Okay, Aadhaar number. You should also put Aadhaar number also. Okay, PAN number, PAN, Aadhaar, all these also personal identifiable information. So, HR department, answer is HR department, correct. Okay, HR only will keep it. But can I say no to other department? Management, what management? I don't know. Okay, management is very general term. So, A is never the answer. Okay. IS department, they may need maybe your biometric data, maybe your email address. So something they may need. So not that they don't need all the personal identifiable, but most likely to store, most likely. HR department, most likely they have to keep your data. Marketing may, some data they may keep. IS department, some data they may. So HR department is most likely. So 10D, good. Now come to operations. This is, we were discussing about this system operations. No, now we are going into system operations. Okay, good. Now, why should organizations want to manage logs? Okay, why should organizations want to manage log? I was just discussing about this particular point. Okay, why should organizations should manage logs? Now, what does logs mean? Okay. Recently, in the month of March, there was actually one notification. So what was the notification by NCIS? You must maintain edit log. The accounting software must maintain edit logs. So what is edit logs? You enter a data in your accounting software, That will be in a log. That log is called transaction log. Now you again log in, maybe 2 months later, 3 months later, or end of the year. You edit that entry. So when you edit that entry or you delete that entry, it should be captured in an edit log. And that edit log, whatever you do, you change the date, you change the amount, you change the person, you change the classification, whatever you edit, it should log. It should take a log of it. That is called edit log. And why this edit log should not be editable. That is also, it is there in that particular MCA notification. This is applicable for all companies. They have not given a threshold exemption also. Okay, and they said from 1st April 2021, you should apply. Then they gave an exemption, no, 1 year later, you can do it. So why should organization want to manage log? Now that's, I have explained everything now. Whatever explained, this is the answer. Please look at this. To be informed when something unusual happens involving a system, correct. To be able to do action in response to a security event, that is also correct. Okay. To keep a record of all the responses, correct. That means all of the above. So this is a very general definition or meaningful question. Why you need a log? Okay. What is the purpose of a log? And even for an audit purpose. And in MCA circular, they have made that particular point, because from a regulator's perspective, whenever they take that accounts copy, okay. Accounts is clean. So that means, is the data that is entered as an entry, it is as such, it is there. That means there is no editor. You have not edited. There are actually 40,000 entries. None of the entries edited. So that means that gives you a doubt. Why? How is it possible? 100% accuracy. That is why edit log is, to err is human, to forgive only divine. That is why log only will tell you that there will be a reason why you have made a, sir, that date belongs to 17 6, it is entered as 17.9. So 17.9 is not correct, it is 17.6 only. So therefore we edited it. So similarly, it is 27, sorry, it is actually 13. Why entering, they typed it as 31. So 13th May, 31st May, lot of differences there. So they would have entered at 31st May. They have changed the date. Similarly, 7,800, they have typed it as 8,700. So I have changed it. So your reason. So it is not that the log should not be there. Only when log is there, they will understand that, okay, accounts is actually true and fair. Okay. So next, when implementing the log management program, it's best to start with. Now this is a very interesting question. It's very interesting. Best to start where? Technology from a trusted vendor. You are implementing a log. Now, March 2021, MCA gave a circular that you should have an edit log. Now, you don't have an edit log in your system. In your accounting system, you put an entry. You wish, you log in, delete it. There is no log. You change it. There is no log. Now, you want to have a log. It is good for audit also. Now, best to start. How will you start? This is actually a very practical question. 100% practical. The same program and process that organizations, similar business are using. So I will call my friend. Hey, which software you are using for edit log? Oh, okay. XYZ. I will also download that. How much is the cost? 7,000. Is this you will do? No. Same program, process, organization. No. That is wrong. B is wrong. Trusted technology, trusted vendor. He'll have that stamp, game, certificate, get you get everything. So will you go further? So A and B is not the answer. Okay. That is a very general point. That means C and D is an answer. Okay. List of top three vendors on published report. Will you go for this kind of advertisement and all? So therefore, ABC is not answer. Therefore, D is the answer. But read D. A careful review of the organization, log management and reporting needs. Very important. I always make this point very clear to you. Please make this point very clear that business is first. Please understand the need of log management. Why do you need a log? You first have to ask this question to you. What is the best to start with? No. MCA has said, so I should have edit log. MCA will say, but do you need an edit log first of all? Yes, because there is a lot of errors happen while entering data. Entries are deleted without authorization. So now deleted entry also, I will have the log. Who logged in, at what time they logged in, at what time they deleted this entry. Midnight 12:39 a.m. that entry was deleted. Oh, serious. Why? And that too on a Sunday. Sunday, early morning, midnight. Okay. Why you actually logged in and then you deleted this entry. So a careful review of the organization log management need and reporting needs. That is first important. So then only you have to go for the implementation. Any ABC you can choose it. So that is not a point at all. Good. The security principle of a least privilege. Now you need to understand this question. Least privilege. Now I will now have to explain to you what is called as privilege creep. Then I'll come for the least privilege. Now what is called as privilege creep? Okay. This is privilege creep. Okay. Privilege creep ahead. Okay. What is privilege creep? Privilege creep. Excessive privileges, access misuse, and employee mistake, insider threat. I'll explain all this first of all. Now, why does privilege creep pose a security risk? Now, generally, access control. What is called access control? Okay. You have discretionary access, mandatory access. What is called discretionary access? Now, assistant manager. Assistant manager, I'll only give access for a certain data. This is his role. Now, COVID times, the number of workforce is less. Okay. So 30% staff, 40% staff, 25% staff. So assistant manager has to do additional responsibility. So then maybe a senior manager's work also, he is assigned, is responsible. Then should I have to give him additional privileges? So by default, he is Ramurthy. Ramurthy has a privilege. That is one login is given. That login, he can only access certain data. He will only be given certain rights to amend the or change the or enter the data or to configure or to reconfigure the, what do you call it as, the parameters, something like that. I have given him privilege. You cannot do beyond that. Sometimes you can change, but it will not be updated. Only the senior manager can update. Now I'm giving him one more privilege. Since the senior manager is not there, you are the guy who will do the change. You are the guy who will approve the change also, because senior manager has to approve. He will propose the change, approval the change. Then only it will be updated in the system. Otherwise, it will be in the memorandum only. Okay. Why does privilege creep pose a security? Now, privilege creep. I am now giving him an additional privilege. Why? Reasons. I am not going into reasons. But is it a security risk? Yes. It is security risk. Why? Go to the answers now. Users' privileges don't match their job or role and responsibility. Correct. So, his role is one, but he is doing another job. So, therefore, A seems to be an answer. Because with more privileges, there are more responsibility. This is like, a Spider-Man. Okay. With more power comes more responsibility. Spider-Man. Okay. So it looks like a slogan. So B is a very general statement. You can ignore it. Okay. So users have more privileges than they need and may use them to perform actions outside of their job description. Okay. So actually C seems to be actually a closer answer. Seems to be A and C, please read it. And which is a security risk, because question is security risk. User privileges don't match their job or role and responsibilities. This seems to be a privilege creep. But is it security risk? No, read C. Users have more privileges, correct. Okay, than they need, correct. And may use them to perform actions outside their job description. See, I'm only describing you, since senior manager is not there, you approve it. Now, I will use that opportunity to go to think beyond, oh, now let me do this, let me do that. So therefore, C seems to be a security risk. Actually, look at A. User privileges don't match their job or role and response because he is assistant manager, I am giving him more responsibility. This seems to be very general. Okay. I don't say that it is a security risk. They don't speak about that at all. Okay, but C speaks about security risk. Now come to D. Auditors may question about a mismatch. That and all later. Why auditor should ask the respect? After everything happens, when the audit, doing the audit, you will ask, why did it happen? No, sir, that day privilege creep happened. That is a different thing. Okay, but first of all, security risk is C. Okay, so 14C. Now come to 13. Now, what is least privilege? Security principle or least privilege? Now, what is least privilege? I will not give him that additional privileges. You are assistant manager. You are stores manager. You are, what do you call it as a trainee. You are a trainee means I'll give you certain access rights. That's all. That is the least privilege. Now, what is the security principle of the principle of least privilege? Why I'm giving least privilege? Okay. The practice of limiting permissions to a minimum level that will allow users to perform the job. What is your job? For that job, what is the access eligible for you? I'll give that alone so that you do that. That is called the least privilege. You are given that privilege to access that server. In that server, you have multiple, divisions. Only the first division, that too, out of 293 folders, only 19 folders you can access. The practice of limiting permissions to the minimum level that will allow the users to perform their job. For you, your job is only with the 19 folder. Go there, access it, download it, and then update it. That's all, man. Your job is that. Why you want to go there? That is what is called least privilege. So 13 matches with A, but let us see B, C, D. Practice of increasing permission. No increasing permissions. So B is wrong. It is limiting permission. Least privilege is limiting. C, the practice of limiting permission, correct, to a level that will allow users to perform their jobs. And those of immediate colleagues, why immediate colleagues? That for him, I'll give is the responsibility. So A and C seems to be very close. What is A? Your job, I'm giving you a least privilege, limiting permission to perform. And those are the immediate colleagues. Immediate colleagues, how will I give least for his, that is his privilege. His privilege, I will not give it to him. For example, Anand, and he is actually a shaker. Shaker's access, why should I give to Anand also? Then responsibility is diluted. Why that privilege is given? Responsibility. Okay. That is why the Spider-Man slogan is very interesting. With the great power comes great responsibility. With the privilege comes responsibility. Okay. Good. So C is not an answer because of the second part. Practice increasing, no increasing permissions. Least privilege increasing. So after that, you need not read it up. So answer is 13A. Software configuration management. Please understand this configuration management. See, whenever this is called software configuration management, hardware configuration management is also there. Software configuration management is also there. See, generally, whenever you buy an operating system, you buy an application software, you install it in your machine. When you install it in your machine, okay, so it will ask, you want to have factory settings, tick, enter, factory settings. This Windows operating system, Apple Mac operating system, when you install it, it will install it with the factory settings. Factory settings are known to everybody. It will be known to me, it will be known to you, it will be known to a perpetrator, it will be known to a fraudster. Everybody will know. That is why configuration means you go and set it. first of all, giving a user ID and a password. Now, sometimes there won't be user ID, there won't be password. Straight away, enter means it will go inside. So that is it a configuration? No, you are not configured at all. Configuration means what? Look at this word configuration. It is an arrangement in a particular form, in a particular combo. That is called configuration. So software configuration is a discipline of systematically controlling. It is a very, very important question to actually understand what is meant by configuration management. Okay. Now let us read all this. Changes due to evolution of work products as the project progresses. Naturally, as your work is increasing, okay, you may need to add more security. You will not allow everybody to access. Maybe if first time you bought the machine, software is there. Somebody wants to see, okay, he's taking it. Nothing is there. First, now only you have bought the machine. But as more datas are there, if more datas are there, will you give that machine to everybody to actually access? No, as it progresses. So you have to configure. Okay, so you will not even allow people to go inside, use that software. All this you will do. So you will have a software user ID password. Inside that file will be there. To open that file, you will give one more password. Okay, so now you can have a password for opening a Microsoft Excel. You can have a password for opening a workbook. You can have a password for accessing a worksheet also. See, the changes required due to defects being found, which are to be fixed. Changes required, okay, due to defects being found, which are to be fixed. Yes, sometimes you may see that your software requires upgradation. Your software, you would not have upgraded for the past 6 months, but already four patches have been announced. So you have not updated those patches. Now, what do? The changes required due to defects being found. Sometimes your software is hanging. You save the software. You save, it doesn't save. It is hanging. Now, you call the guy, what is this, your software? I paid 4 lakhs for your software. Sir, we have given 4 patches. Did you upgrade it? No, I didn't. So that is called software configuration management for systematically controlled to bring discipline. So B is also an answer. Changes necessary due to change in requirement. Now, your requirement will change because you may need to use that particular software for certain applications, for certain priorities. You may need to customize it. Okay. Because of your job requirements, because of your project requirements. So then you have to configure your software. So configuring your software, for example, accounting software. Changes required due to change in requirements. Accounting software, very simple example. Now your TDS rates have changed. Now the moment you want to pass an entry with respect to a vendor payment, immediately it will say, the TDS has to be calculated. Rate, if you have put it in the background, it will calculate and it will show, should I have to deduct it? Press yes, enter means yes. Now, if the rate is old, that means old configuration. Now, you have to configure again. That means all of the above. So, 15D is a configuration. Which of the following is top priority that company is planning to implement an asset management system should examine? Top priority. Okay, which of the following is top priority? Now, please understand this AMS, implement an asset management system. Planning to implement. So that means they have not implemented, but they are only planning to implement an asset management system. Now, what will be an asset management system? It can be your application software you want to manage. So you want to actually implement an asset management system. So which is a top priority for you? The visual appeals of website, internal search pages, and marketing collaterals. Will that be your top priority? That is only to enhance your maybe appeals and all. Number of videos, audio files, and other multimedia. That also you can add. What is it? Okay. These are all not top priority. I will say, okay. Okay. Maybe you want to implement asset management system. Okay. So what is an asset management? You want to go for a new website. because it looks like from the answer they are speaking about a new website. Okay. And the specific data needs and business problems to be solved. This is most important. Why you need a website? Why you need a new web server? Why you need a new data server? Okay. The new data server, you need to understand your business problem and your data needs. Then only you have to go for implementation. So all of the above is not the answer. C is the answer. Because A and B is not top priority. Okay. So maybe if the question is instead of top priority, they say which of the following should be considered. I will say A, B, C, all will be considered. Okay. But here the word is top. Okay. So that is C is top. Then only A, R, B and all will come. Okay. It is not the visual appeal. I don't want a visual. I don't need a visual appeal for my website, for my front end and all. So, but that is not top priority. Okay. This is asset management systems. So all assets in one place, identify manage risk, produce accurate detail audit, track all records. Okay. So this is what this is all about. Now look at this. Now IT support. Now sometimes you troubleshooting. You will do self troubleshooting. You will call the help desk. Sir, it is COVID time. We can't come. You manage yourself. You have a manual, and all. Read the manual. Okay, and then you try to land the plane yourself. We don't know. We can't come and help you. That is called tier zero support. Tier zero means no support. Self support. Namakku name thittam. Okay. So self service means level zero. So 17B. But please look at this. What is tier four? Support powered by vendor. Vendor will come and give you support. That is tier four, top. Because you can't do anything. Some problem, you don't know what to do at all. So the vendor will come. The respect to hardware vendor because it's a hardware problem. The respect to software vendor will come because it's a software problem. That is called tier four. Now, what is tier one? Solving basic issues, answering general question about software functionality. I'll just ask him, sir, it's very simple. There is a patch number 4.1.3. That 4.1.3, is it downloaded and updated? No, I have not done it. Then do that. So now tier zero self-support. Tier one, you got a query and he answered and now you are doing it yourself. Here also you did it yourself. Tier zero and tier one, both self-support only. But tier one, after getting some answer, you are doing it yourself. In-depth technical support. You say, go left, go right, go straight, come down, click this, click green. So then you will go as per him and then you do it. So here it is in-depth technical support. This is called support. Okay. So you do it, but you get the support. So this is the tier, and please understand this kind of questions also can come. During development of a software system, which of the following will be used to maintain software integrity? During development of a software system, which of the following will be used to maintain software integrity? Okay. Now software integrity. Now, please understand, data integrity is different. Software integrity is different. Oh, what is software integrity? That means you maintain the originality of the software. Array. Now, what is the special about it? Now, during development of a software system, which of the following will be used to maintain software integrity? Development of a software system. This is a question you need to answer yesterday. Okay, yesterday only it was system development lifecycle. Now I developed the software and I've given it to the customer. Customer is using it, happy. Now, does it stop here? It is called system development and acquisition and implementation and maintenance. Maintenance. Now, what is it? Now, he will give all the feedback. This is not there, that is not there, this is not working, that is not working. Now I'll go inside my software coding. I will develop a version 1.1. Because 1.2 I have given, then 1.1 I'll give. Then 1.2 I'll give, 1.3 I'll give, 1.4 I'll give. Now he will say, now another his customers, he is having in Gujarat. Ahmedabad or in Surat, there is one branch. That branch guy is calling, sir, this problem is there, I'm not able to do it. Then I will ask him, software integrity control, which version, please go to about the software, tell me which version it is. Sir, it is 1.2. Array, we have developed 1.3, 1.4, 1.5, we are now in 1.7. So 1.7 you should update, you are in 1.3. So four updates we have done it. That is software integrity. So during development of a software, which of the following will be used to maintain software integrity? Because the error what you have said, it is there in 1.3. But we have rectified that error in 1.7. Okay, that is called version control. Version. So 18B version. Change management, it is a different concept. Configuration management, just now I discussed. What is configuration management? So none of the above is not the answer. Change management is actually you set the parameters. What is the parameter? Interest rate 7.5%. You go and change the interest rates. No, it is 8.5%. No, it is 6.5%. Now, who logged in? When he logged in? What time he logged in? When he changed it? What is the original data? What is the changed data? And is he given any reason for the change? All these will be there in change management. You cannot just like that go and edit it and change 7.5 to 6.5. It will not allow you to do it. It will say you change it, it will accept. There will be a reason. You have to give a reason. That will be a red color star. You have to type it. They will say reason, you have to give at least 2 lines. If you give only 2 words, it will not agree. You have to narrate it. That narration is very important. That is change management. Okay. So 18C is not answer, it's a version control. Change management is with respect to parameter changes. When any of the parameters in configuration, you set a parameter and that parameter you change, then change management. Okay. Who of the following would approve or reject major changes? Approve. What is configuration? It can be hardware configuration, software configuration. Now, who will approve? Top management will approve. Always approval means top management. Senior management or top management. Whether senior management, no, system admin, user, no. User only will change it. Manage, look at A and B. A and B is the answer. But which is the right answer? Who? Is it management? Management can be middle management. Management can be lower management. Management can be senior management. They have to very clearly say. Cannot say management means always senior management. Okay. So change control board. What is change control board? It is a group of individuals responsible for reviewing and analyzing change requests. That's called change control board. Okay, top management. So who is there? Who will approve or reject the change control board? So 19B. Good. A transaction, okay, a transaction in a database system should be atomic in nature. Now you should understand what is called as ACID. What is ACID? Atomicity, ACID. Remember this ACID, acid property. It's called acid property. In your IRCTC website, IRCTC website will have acid property. Your bank websites will have acid property. Now, you withdraw your money from ATM. You deposit money. You do a transaction in a bank. You deposit 50,000 fixed deposits. Okay. Now, you don't... say 5 lakhs you have deposited, okay? 5 lakhs you have deposited, fixed deposit, and you have forgotten. 3 years, 4 years you have forgotten. Now, somewhere in draw that FD receipt is there, now you go and ask. You are asking, what happened to my fixed deposit? No, sir, since you are not responding, every year 110 got reduced. First year, 10 gone. 5 lakh became 50,000. Second year, another 0 gone. 50,000 became 5,000. Third year, another 0 gone. 5,000 became 500. Now, a fourth year, you are now here. Now, 500 became 50. Only 50 rupees that now take it. Will it happen? Okay. Atomicity, consistency, isolation, durability. So, a CA qualification is forever. Marriages are forever. Diamonds are forever. A transaction done in a transaction processing system is forever. That is what is called durability. Now, what is acid? Acid like A is called atomicity. Atomicity means... either all occurs or nothing occurs. You do a transaction. You ask for a 10,000 rupees withdrawal. Okay. Now, if there is only 7,000 cash is there in the in the ATM machine, only 7,000 cash is there. Will it give 7,000 to you? No, 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 sorry. I have only in my pockets. Only human will do that. You ask 10,000, now I have 7,000. So that emotion, okay, commotion, situation, everything human beings will understand. So, okay, you ask 10,000, I'm giving you 7. Well, machine will give that. Machine will only say one answer. You ask 10,000, you cannot be done. So, insufficient funds. You will worry, I have 60,000 in my account. How can you say insufficient funds? Insufficient not in your account, insufficient with my account. Bank says, I don't have funds. So, that is why it says, either it will occur or it will not occur. That is called atomicity. Okay. So, a transaction is atomic, means transaction shall be submitted by a user. Transaction should be either completed or not completed. So, B is answer. Complete or incomplete? Sorry, you know, complete or not complete? Not incomplete. Incomplete means part of the transaction. You ask 10, 7 only is complete. Balance 3, that is incomplete. Incomplete will never happen in atomicity. No or yes only. It is not in between. Okay. So that is why you want to book 7 tickets for a train. Actually, only 3 tickets are there. You ask for 7. It will say no tickets are not available. You see, 3 is there, but you are asking 7. For it is a machine. You should say, if 3 is there, ask 3. It will allot you. If 3 is there, you ask for only 3 Italy's. Is there? How can I give 7 Italy? It can't. It is a no. It is a machine. It is not a human being. Okay. Now, software operations management, very important. Okay. What is the main focus of acceptance testing? Okay. This acceptance testing is, it is user sign off. Okay. Now, already, maybe I've just given this, I'll once again, I've given here. Maybe this testing, this is actually yesterday's question. But anyhow, it has come here also. What is the main focus of acceptance testing? Ensure that the system is acceptable to management. Management should accept. No. Okay. It is not for management. Who has to accept? User only has to accept. So management is wrong. Accepting errors and bugs in the system. No, that is not acceptance. Acceptance means my requirement, whether it is satisfied in the software. Okay. Who has to say? User have to sign. Ensuring that the system is acceptable to user. Correct. C is the answer. Okay. Now let us see D. Ensuring the system is acceptable to auditors. No. Auditor and all will come later. Good. Which of the following tests should be carried out when individual software modules are combined together as a group? This is again testing. So individual software modules are combined together. So module 1, module 2. Now there is a big software. Okay, with 50,000 coding or 150,000 codes, you divide it into 10,000 line codes. Now this is called one unit. One unit you have tested is working very well. One depreciation module also working very well. Balance sheet alone working very well. Now depreciation has to be implemented because that is accumulated depreciation. So now that is called integration testing. Modules are combined. When you are combined, you should do integration. Unit testing is for a single unit. System testing is for the entire complete system. Okay. White box testing means, black box means you give the input, see the output. You put input, padar, now see that side. You don't see the process. If you see the process, it is called white box testing. Yeah, it is going inside, then it is coming out. Okay, going here, going out, coming out. That's called white box testing. So here it is called integration testing, 22A. Which of the following should be reviewed for providing assurance of the database referential integrity? Now, what is called referential integrity? Referential integrity means you have two databases, table 1, table 2. Look at this, table 1, table 2. Now, table 1 is your student database. Table 2 is your result database. Table 1, student database, name, name, father's name, address, SRO number. Okay, another stuff. Now, result database, name, roll number, SRO number, and then group, subjects, marks. Between these two tables, which is a common field, a connecting common field between both, SRO number. SRO number. And that SRO number is called foreign key. Why it is foreign key? This key means that is called a field. Key means a key field, important field. That field is able to refer to another field. Then if you connect both these tables, you can only connect both these tables through a foreign key. Okay. Which of the following should be reviewed to provide assurance of the database referential integrity? Now, if none of the field is common, you cannot refer. That connect is connect cannot be. So you may say, I'm related to him. How I'm related? My wife's sister's husband's. Okay. Then like that, and then my wife's sister's husband's and his cousins. Okay. And his in-law. So that in that way, I'm related. So referential. See how one table to another table, one table to another table, one table to another table. So that means there's a foreign key. Okay, so there's a connect between my family and that family, that family and that family, that family and that family, this table and this table. This is called foreign key. Not field. Field definition means one column explaining what it is in numeric or alpha, alpha numeric, lotto, losto, everything. So that is called composite key means combining two fields together. Foreign key means one key connecting to another table. Okay, that is called referential integrity. 23D. When evaluating the effectiveness, okay. When evaluating the effectiveness and adequacy of preventive computer maintenance, okay, remember this word preventive. Why preventive means my software, my hardware guy will come. This is with respect to computer maintenance, so hardware. The computer guy will come monthly once. Sir, give me your laptop, give me your desktop. He will go and test everything, do all the check, he will do it. And then, sir, everything is okay. Go ahead. Please sign this. When evaluating the effectiveness and adequacy of the preventive computer maintenance, when he is going, he will take my signature. Sir, please sign, sir. I will put date, time, what he did. Then I have to give a remarks. Then I will sign it. Wow. What is that? That is called system downtime log, vendor's reliability figures. Okay. Is it regularly scheduled maintenance log? Yes. There is a regularly scheduled maintenance log. But does it give effectiveness of that maintenance? No. That will not give effectiveness. Now, just by maintaining, after maintenance, between maintenance date 1, maintenance date 2, whether your computer is running or it is down. That means I need a downtime log. Date, time, when it was shut down, what is the downtime reason? That log I want. And also I need the regularly scheduled maintenance. Sir, I have done this regular scheduling. Very good. That is actually to know the efficiency of the vendor. If whether vendor is efficient or not, I will see that log. But whether the system is efficient, if the system is effective, whether preventive maintenance, you have paid monthly 10,000 rupees, monthly 4 lakhs for all the machines, whether that is actually effective, whether downtime log is there, I will see the downtime log. So 24A, if downtime log is only 1 or 2 is there, sir, that is only because of power fluctuation, not because of maintenance. Okay. A written preventive maintenance schedule, that is he has to comply with. Now, written preventive maintenance schedule is like your people will give you the bank loan. When you go for NBFC or bank loan, they'll give you one repayment schedule. That this month, this you have to pay this month. That is repayment schedule. That repayment schedule will give you the effectiveness. No, you have to pay on time. Then only it is effectiveness. If you don't pay on time, then it is downtime. Then your check will bounce. Then your credit score will come down. Your credit score, I have to see. So that is 24A. 24A is the system downtime log. That only will give the effectiveness. In a relational database, so two table connecting with the foreign key, that is called relations. A record, record means a row. Okay. Name, father's name, date of birth, age, mobile number, email ID, SRO number, a student record. That is called tuple. Okay. Tuple is a single row. Tuple means a single. Okay, it is not. See, they don't call it as row. It is row only. but say there is advertisement in Tata Salt. Okay, Tata Namak. Aaj se namak ko namak nahi kehna, Tata Namak kehna. You should not say salt. From today, you should not say salt. Inime upu upu nu solakuda. Tata upu nu daan solano. Okay. So, aaj se namak ko namak nahi kehna. Tata Namak kehna. Okay. So, you should not say salt as salt. It is called Tata Salt. So, henceforth, the row should not be called as row. It is called as record or it is called as tuples. You should not call it a column. You should call it as field. Okay. Sometime field, like key field will be there. Key field. So it's called tuple 25A. Which of the following will ensure that a column in a table will have a valid value or shall be null in another table's column? Oh, look at this small things. Huh? Which of the following will ensure that a column in one table will have a valid value or null value in another column's table? So that I already had discussed this particular point. Okay. So I said you have a column, for example, the same student's record and result. Student and result is very insane. Student record, original record, result, then member's record. Now you have become a member. So that means a member database will be there. What is member database? Membership number. Okay. Then name. Are you FCA or ACA? Are you in practice or not? And what is your address? What is your PIN code? What is your email ID, phone number? That will be there. Now that member database has to be connected to your result database and your student database. So your original student database had SRO number. Result database had a roll number and SRO number. Your membership table, okay, database will have membership number and SRO number. So then only this, using SRO number, I will connect to the, now look at this word. Which of the following will ensure that a column in a table will have valid value or null value? Now why null value? Now Gopal Krishna Raju, membership number 205929. My SRO number will also be there in there. Now this SRO number, if I go and check with May 2019 result, null value only will be there. Why? I am not qualified in May 2019. I qualified in 1990s. Those period, I am a 90s kids. That period only I qualified. So it will give a null value only. So I should go to the 90s, that result table. When you compare, then only it will say, yeah, data found. Then you go to my, from here you can connect to my student record. Student record, member record, SRO will get connected. But student member record to result record, that particular result when I appeared for examination only, if you go, it will say, other it will be null value. That is called foreign key. That key is called foreign key. Okay. So 26D. Of course, it is called primary key. Membership number is primary key. Your SRO number is primary key. One primary key connected with another primary key. That is what it is called. Here it is a primary key. There it is a foreign key. Okay. That is why the word foreign key word is very important. Normalization. Remember now here in my student database also SRO number is there. Result database also SRO number is there. Member database SRO number is there. Is it not duplication? Is it not redundancy? Redundancy of data. So redundancy of data will actually occupy space. My efficiency will drop down. Okay. So what to do? What is called data normalization? Data normalization is a process of optimization. Okay. It is a process by which data structures are made efficient by eliminating redundancy. The duplication and all, it will eliminate. Thereby, space will be minimized. The connectivity can be established better. That is called relational. The relation between table 1 to table 2 and n tables can be connected properly. So what is data normalization? Is it data redundancy optimization? Yes. 27A. Okay. Data logging and accountability? No. Streamlining data process. Streamlining means arranging. Maybe year-wise, alphabet-wise, okay, and data birth-wise, something like that. Okay, that is called streamlining. Okay, or PIN code-wise, something. deleting temporary file, deleting temporary temp file is not database normalization. It is removing additional, it is removing space. I mean, it is creating space by removing unwanted files, temp files. That is not database normalization. Database normalization is data redundancy optimization. That means duplicate data will be removed unwanted. So wanted, that means primary key, it is wanted. But if it is same primary key, you have 3-4 columns. Why you need 3-4 columns? Remove it. Which of the following is not a property? We already know ACID. What is ACID? Atomicity, consistency, isolation, durability. Atomicity, consistency, durability. Isolation, insulation is wrong. Insulation is wrong. It's called isolation. 28C. Why isolation? In a server, thousands of transactions will come. I am a Bank of Maharashtra server. Bank of Maharashtra server. I am connected to 3,000 branches across the country. A transaction will be coming in. Now, from all the branches, transaction will come. Now, will I do simultaneously all transaction? No. Wrong. I'll only do one transaction at a time. At a time. Oh my God. Then it will be very slow. No. For us, generally when we say, hey, 1 minute, please wait. 1 second, please wait. 1 second is the least time for a human being. But 1 second is a huge time for a machine. Huge. 1 second you divide into piece, 1,000 pieces, it's called millisecond. 1 millisecond you divide into 1,000 pieces, it is called 1 microsecond. 1 microsecond you have to 1,000 pieces, it is called 1 nanosecond. 1 nanosecond you divide into 1,000 pieces, it's called 1 picosecond. So, 1 millionth, 1 billionth, 1 trillionth of a second is called 1 picosecond. So, 1 second, 1 trillion transactions it can process. My God, mind boggling, you know. In 1 second, only 1 chutki I can make. So, how many chutkis you can make? 2 or 3, that's all. But in one, they call it as, what is call it as? The hertz. Hertz means times per second. H-E-R-T-Z. In 1 second, it can tick. Tick 1 trillion times it can tick. 1 second. My God, it is not humanly possible. But machine is possible. Okay, that is called, that is why it's called isolation. Not insulation. 28C. After discovering a security vulnerability in a third-party application, okay, that interfaces with several external systems, a patch is applied. Oh, okay, a patch is applied to a significant number of modules. Which of the following tests should an IS auditor recommend? Oh, a patch is applied. Okay, patch means a version. Version 14.3.1. Okay, there is security vulnerability and a patch is applied. Which of the following testing an IS auditor should recommend? Stress testing is only to test whether load it can take. It is generally done for a telecommunication or the data load. So stress is not the answer. Now black box testing, interface testing. Interface is between unit to unit data. Does it go properly? So therefore interface is also not an answer. So stress and interface not an answer. Now black box system testing. Now what is black box? I put a data and look at answer alone. I will not see. Now what is a patch is applied to significant number of modules. It's very important. There are 17 modules, 14 modules I have actually updated. My God. Then will you do black box testing? No, you have to do system testing. Okay, 29D, you have to do system. Maybe you have to do complete testing. So maybe you put the entry, see the output. You have to do the unit testing, interface testing, okay, black box testing, white box testing. So the entire system, whether it gives you the output with respect to the requirements. So system testing means, what is your user requirement? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 93 user requirements will be there. All 93 user requirement, does the system deliver? That is called system testing. It is complete testing. system testing is complete because significant number of modules have been updated. An organization has recently installed a security patch, okay, which crashed the production server. Chicho, okay. So I just updated the Damal server. To minimize the probability of this occurring again, an IS auditor should apply the patch according to patch release notes, ensure that a good change management process is in place. Now I'm coming for a very, very important. Generally, when you use a software, it will come. You have a new update. Please click this to update. You damal, you go and click. Your system, it actually crashes. Damn. Everything becomes black. Oh my God, is it a virus or what? Then what you should do? What you should do? Whenever an organization recently installed a security patch which crashed, to minimize the probability, again, what IS auditor should recommend? Whenever a new patch is coming, security patch is coming, first ensure the veracity, originality with the source. So you send an email and say whether you have sent it, should I have to install, please confirm when I have to install. Okay, is it required for my requirements? You already know my requirement, you have installed the software. So they will confirm it. Sometimes such patch will come from an unknown person in the name of a security patch. Okay, so that is very, very serious. So you have to confirm. Second, these are all called good change management process. Anything you change, you first confirm. You first understand whether that patch is required for you. Okay, sometimes you don't require that patch just because iOS is sending one update. You please update your mobile phone. A new update is available. Should I have to update? We don't do all those testing at all. We update it. Maybe we think that will be useful. Please understand that security, that particular patch, what and all the benefits it will give it to you. You go and study that. It will say the screen display will be increased, that will be done, this will be done, previously this problem was, that problem is removed. It will give a very big story. Read all those things, think whether that is relevant for you. Then if it is relevant, then install. Okay, that is very important. So, and minimize the probability, apply the patch according to the patch release notes. Release notes, you'll say it is 11.1.1 like that, okay. That is not. You have to understand the change management process. What is change management? What is the changes they have brought? Is it required for you? Does you have the problem? Does that patch rectify that problem? All this you have to know, document it. And then you confirm that with the source vendor. Now whether it will... So that, and take a backup properly. Software backup, data backup properly. If something happens, then you have to restore the system. So therefore, all these you have to do manually. Because live data, production data is serious. Okay, good. Thoroughly test the patch before sending it to production. Of course, this IS auditor, it's not the role of IS auditor, it's the role of the developer. Okay. Approve the patch after doing a risk assessment. No, that I will not do. Developer only will do. Okay. You are only a user. User will not do the approve the patching and all. Thoroughly testing the patch, I will not do. I will only go for A and B. But out of A and B, which will minimize the error? Minimize the error, a good change management process. Okay. So 30B. So guys, I'll stop here. I'm sure we have done a good amount of coverage today. I'll just request two or three of our friends to share your thoughts. May I now request CAP Edu Kondalu. Mr. Edu Kondalu, may I request you to unmute your mic, please. And I'll also request another friend. we'll ask Mr. Divya Bharati. Divya Bharati, can I request you to share your thoughts, please? And I'll also request Mr. Payaniappan Sundaram. Can you unmute, please? Mr. Payaniappan Sundaram or Mr. Payanisamy Senthil. Or who wish to actually share your thoughts, you can raise your hand. Oh, yeah, we have Mr. Arun. We'll request Mr. Arun of Kozhikode branch chairman. Very good morning, Mr. Arun.
Very good morning, sir. Very good morning.
So may I just request you to share your thoughts, please?
So the class is going really good. It's actually really helping us a lot to understand the basics of the topics, because I myself is a batchmate of 2014 ISA batch, actually, of which I cleared the ET but could not clear off ET due to certain reasons. A couple of times attempted, then the syllabus got changed, then thought we'll do after a point of time. But now itself, it's a refreshing course. As gone for a refreshing course, it is not like a refresher. It is actually going like a regular class itself, because we are getting updated with almost what are the key points which we need to see as such in answering a question. So that itself gives us a lot of confidence that we can have a test on ourselves for how did we fail for the last couple of times. So the persons who are attempting for the first time, definitely it would be words of motivation, because these words really matter a lot. Also, as a couple of faculties yesterday and the day before told, plain English reading is not required. The deepest study of English reading is required. So thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for having this refresher course and great learning session, sir. Thank you.
So nice of you, Mr. Arun. And we'll now request Bindu. May I request Bindu? And after that, we'll hear from Shanmuga Sundar. Bindu, can you unmute yourself and share your thoughts, please?
Sir, can you hear me, sir?
Absolutely clear and loud. Please go ahead. Kindly introduce yourself.
Sir, your presentation is very excellent, sir. We will get a grip over the topic, sir. Really request you to give top other subjects like GST, taxation. Your knowledge is very appreciable, sir. We will be very grateful to you, sir.
Thank you. Which place you are from, Bindu?
I am from Trivandrum.
Okay. Yeah,
so practicing CA in Karamanas.
Karaman. Okay. Best wishes, madam. And let us now hear from Shanmuga Sundar. Shanmuga Sundar, very good morning.
Good morning, sir. This is Shanmuga Sundar from Bangalore. Can you hear me?
Absolutely clear and loud. Clear.
Yeah.
Please go ahead.
Sir, your method of teaching is very excellent. I actually cleared ISA in the year 2011, both ET and AT in one shot. Now I joined this course only for refreshing, you know, the knowledge. But nobody ever taught the way you taught. No, why out of the four options, the three are not okay, you know. Everybody said, just say, pick the right answer and put it. So this way our knowledge improves, overall knowledge. And that is very excellent. I am really enjoying these sessions. It is very useful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shanmuga Sundar. We really appreciate your thirst to upskill. It is like reskilling and upskilling yourself. So nice, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So now,
good morning, sir.
Mr. Darshan Rathore.
I am from Balaghat, Madhya Pradesh. I have also cleared my visa in 2003. But I have joined this course for refreshing only, and I am very benefited from this. And your deliberations are very good. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Darshan Bhai. And aap kaun sa gaon se baat kar rahe hain?
But Balaghat, Madhya Pradesh, sir.
Oh, okay, Madhya Pradesh.
Kanha National Park is there in Balaghat, Madhya Pradesh.
Yeah. Very famous.
If you come here, you can contact me.
Oh, wonderful. Darshan Bhai, definitely. We'll do that.
Thank you, sir.
So nice of you. Best wishes, Darshan Bhai.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So now, I will hand over the session back to chairman of Guntur branch for your closing remarks.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Sir, we all have one problem, sir. We read the section.
No, your voice is very low.
Okay, sir, now. Hello?
Speak loudly, sir.
Yeah. I'm audible. Okay.
Yeah, please.
Yes.
Sir, we have a human nature is we just read the problem, the act, whatever may be the act, it may be an income tax or GST. Out of the 20%, we skip them. Why? Because we doesn't understand or we doesn't want to see that portions. But unlike us, GKR, I am abbreviated as Global Knowledge Repository. Sir, don't let any 1% of any act is dealing. If any doubt, he will go into the root, rectify the doubts, then only he speaks. I came to know this with this journey, sir. Thank you very much, sir, GK, sir, for your excellent presentation. Thank you. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I'll be back again on day 6.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Over to Sika, sir, chairman. Vote of thanks to Law.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Chairman, sir. And thank you, today's speaker, Gopalakrishnaraju, sir. Sir, today is a wonderful session. We have a understanding of out of four, why one is correct, why other three are not correct. Thank you for your question, answer, and explanation of the things. Thank you so much, sir. Again, we will meet on day 6 with you, sir. And tomorrow, again, we will start at 8:20 sharp. Please come to the session online by 8:20. We will start by 8:20 or 8:25 maximum. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.